Hello everybody, and welcome to the first video lecture for Structural Equation Modeling 1. I usually start my lectures with a short recap of the previous lecture, or in this case, of multivariate statistics. And for this course, I want to try something different. I want to try to record these recaps beforehand, so we have more time in the lecture to go through other things, and also so that you can look at these at home. In this video lecture, I want to go through some basic concepts of multivariate statistics. These concepts, I assume, are known before starting this course, and they're also pretty important. So I'll talk about what a matrix is, what matrix algebra is, or matrix multiplication, what a covariance matrix is, and what a mean vector is. I'll go through these concepts again to also establish my notation, and also as a refresher for some of these things. In general, I will use the following notation. So a bold-faced letter will always mean a matrix or a vector, and a lowercase letter will mean a scalar, which is simply a number. So in this case, this uppercase Y means this matrix, which has many numbers. So this could be your data, or a covariance matrix, or a vector Lonex matrix. The lowercase Y here indicates a vector, which is always a column. A column is a vertical bar, a row is a horizontal bar. And a vector always indicates a set of numbers. And this lowercase y here is a scalar, which is simply a number. Now these subscripts will indicate subparts of a bigger structure. So here, lowercase y2 indicates the second row, so 4, 5, 6, of this matrix Y. And if we take a vector, it will always automatically be encoded as a column as well. I'll use the subscript to denote rows, sometimes also to denote columns. It will usually be clear if it denotes a row or column. Here we see Y2,3. The first subscript will always denote the row of a matrix. The second subscript will always denote the column of a matrix. So this is element row 2, column 3. Matrix Y, which is row 2, is 4, 5, 6 here. Column 3 is 3, 6, 9, 12, so that's the 6 here. We will see this a lot, and also in structural equation modeling, it is pretty useful to have this notation correct, so that you can really see what you're doing and where you're getting your elements from. In general, I will use Roman letters and Greek letters, and this is pretty common in statistics. I will use a Roman letter to mean something that's observed. So the Y, for example, will indicate the data or observed scores, or something that's specified, which you could also say is observed. So the sample size, N, will mean something that we can know. A Greek letter, on the other hand, will indicate something that is not observed, or something that we don't necessarily know. For example, I'll use this eta to indicate latent variable score, or this lambda here to indicate a vector Lonex matrix. In general, these Greek letters will either be latent variables or parameters. And the difference between a latent variable and a parameter is that a latent variable will have a distribution. I'll come back to that in the lecture. Now, when I was a student, I saw all these Greek letters as well, and I tried to remember them, like upside down, y, times some sort of B, times something that looks like a table. And at some point I got really lost. So at some point I actually went to Google and looked up Greek alphabet and tried to remember these names, and that really helps. So that's why I put them in the slides here. It really helps to actually understand how you pronounce each letter, because it helps you think about these letters. So instead of thinking about upside down Y, you can think about lambda, or mu, or rho, pi. In general, we'll use quite a lot of these letters, so it's useful to know the alphabet. The main letters we will use here are, let's see, eta. Eta will indicate latent variables. Theta. Theta will indicate residuals. Lambda. Lambda will indicate vector loadings. Then we have psi here. Psi will indicate variance and covariance at the latent level. And I think those will be the most important ones. We'll use tau, maybe alpha, maybe beta at some point, especially in SEM2. Mu, I guess, we'll use as well. A very important operator for matrices is the transpose. The transpose, which I will indicate with this capital T, which you'll see it sometimes in the literature with an apostrophe as well, or a tick mark, indicates that we mirror our matrix. So here I have our matrix Y, which has rows, four rows. So this is row 1, row 2 is 4, 5, 6, row 3 is 7, 8, 9, row 4 is 10, 11, 12. And it has three columns. Now, if you do the transpose, then we will make each row a column, each column a row. So now you can see that in Y transpose, row 1 was column 1 of the previous Y matrix. A vector transpose will become a row vector. So Y subscript 2 transposed will indicate row 2 of matrix Y, which was 4, 5, 6. But because it was a vector, it became a column automatically. So if you transpose it, it becomes a row vector. 4, 5, 6 as a row. Matrix multiplication. Now, matrix multiplication is a very important concept in structural equation modeling. And in general, in SEM 1 especially, I will not really go into much mathematical detail. The aim of this course is more applied. But still, it is really useful to know how you do matrix multiplication, because we'll see it often. And I think it's useful to know the mathematics behind things as well. So a matrix multiplication is a generalized form of multiplying two numbers. So say if you have A times B equals C, then A times B, if A is 2 and B is 4, then 2 times 4 is 8. But in matrices, it's a bit more complicated. In general, if you have a matrix and we multiply it with another matrix, what we're not doing is multiplying this element with this element. Instead, we are multiplying this element with this, plus this element with this, plus this element with that. And that will give us 56. That looks really complicated, but I really like this trick. And I learned this in high school, and every time I do a matrix multiplication, I still write it down like this, because otherwise I just cannot understand what's happening. So if you have A times B here, I can write it like this. A times B, I put B here, and this matrix will become C, my result. Now I can see that the columns of A must match the number of rows in B, because this must be equal to each other. If I now want to compute this element here, I can look at everything on the left, and then I can say A, 1, 1, times B, 1, 2, plus A, 1, 2, times B, 2, 2. And you can see that you move closer to the element here in B, row 1, column 2. And this is a really useful trick. It really helps me think about what goes in here, what sum goes in here. So that's a visual way of doing it. In general, this is the formula. And we take a sum over every element in a row of A and a column of B. In R, we use this percentage symbol, asterisk, percentage symbol operator to compute this. Do not use the asterisk symbol itself. It will do element-wise multiplication and you'll have a wrong result. All right, on to a bit more statistical concepts. In general, in this course, we will assume our data to be multivariate normally distributed. In the last lecture, we'll make some exceptions, and I'll talk a bit about what to do with your data ordinal. But in general, I'm going to assume that every variable is normally distributed, and actually that the entire set of variables is multivariate normally distributed. Now here we see two Greek letters already. This symbol means Y is distributed as a normal distribution. So this tilde means is distributed as, this N means normal, with a parameter vector called mu, which encodes the means, and a parameter vector called sigma, which encodes the variance covariance structure. So Y can be is a vector, so it's a set of items. So this can be a response vector to 5 items, for example. And I assume these have a normal distribution with some means and some variance covariance structure. The variance covariance structure is similar to a correlation matrix, but then it's not standardized yet. And I'll come back to that. Now, what does it mean that a variable is normally distributed or multivariate normally distributed? It means that if you look at these histograms, from every side, it must have this bell shape, which you will know. But it means something else as well. It means that from the top, these scatter plots will all have oval shapes. And that means that there's only linear relationships between the variables. That's a very important assumption. If you don't have linear relationships, then multivariate normality doesn't hold. Now, why do we assume multivariate normality? That's a bit of a technical concept. But one main reason is that we are doing multivariate statistics, and there are actually not that many distributions that allow you to form a multivariate distribution. Usually many distributions are only for one variable, not for the joint, so not for the combination of y and x in this case. But also the multivariate normality normal distribution is what's called the maximum entropy distribution. And that means that it's actually the least specific distribution that will give rise to a certain set of means and variance covariances. This is a very technical concept, so you can forget about it. But I like to say it because it means that it's actually the least specific distribution we can assume given our correlational structure, which is pretty nice. Now here I have a data set. In general, the data Y, capital letters and matrix, will indicate a data set. And here we can see that Y actually consists of a row vector on each row. So this is a block matrix where every row is a matrix again, or a vector. And this means that this is the score pattern of person 1, this means the score pattern of person 2, this means it's the score pattern of person 3, etc. This is just to show what Y looks like in this case. Now in a normal distribution, and I'll just take a very simple example here and only have a univariate normal distribution of one variable. In a normal distribution, the center of the distribution is controlled by its mean, which is called mu. So the center of, in this case, yj, it's a random variable, so I dropped the subscript of the subject here, so it indicates it's random, is controlled by mean. And we can also compute these means from the data. These are what we call sample descriptives or descriptive statistics. So what I can do is I can compute per column the mean. I can do that by saying I want to sum all values in a column and then divide that by 1 over n, the number of people. So in our case here, if we want to have the mean of variable 1, we would sum 4.09 with 2.48 with 4.93, etc. Then divide that result by n. And then we get what's called the sample mean. We can combine it in a vector, which I will call y with a bar on top. And then we get 3 elements in a vector corresponding to 3 means. In R, we can do that with call means. Now, if you know a bit about mathematical statistics, or actually if you know a lot about mathematical statistics, then you might know that this estimator is actually what's called an unbiased estimator for the mean mu, which is pretty cool. So this, the notation here indicates the expected value of this sample mean equals mu. That is not very important for circular equation modeling 1, but I'll come back to expectation algebra in circular equation modeling 2, and then you will also understand a bit more what this means. The sigma matrix, the variance covariance matrix, corresponds to the variances and the covariances. So it means it's on this diagonal, it's a square matrix. I'll draw this. A square matrix, with on the diagonal the variances, and on the off diagonal the covariances. With this notation, I indicate that sigma squared j equals sigma jj. Sigma jj equals the element of sigma, So this is the diagonal element, the jth diagonal element of sigma. And sometimes you see it notated as this. I like the notation with the double j better because it indicates it's a subset of this matrix. But sometimes you'll see this sigma square j, which is the same thing. The square root equals the standard deviation, and that's the spread of this normal distribution. So you might know that from forming, for example, a 95% confidence interval, if you have the standard error. Standard error is the variance of the parameter. Now the covariance, so these off-diagonal elements of sigma, indicate association. And in general, you can understand it by taking a plot of one variable with another, drawing these lines at the means, and then if two variables are positively correlated, that means that there will be a lot of points in this top right and this bottom left quadrant, and only a few points in the top left and the bottom right quadrants. If it's negatively correlated, you'll have a lot of elements in the top left and bottom right quadrants instead. The covariance is an unstandardized form of that, and the higher it is, that means the stronger the association between two variables. Now, usually it's useful to standardize these to correlations, and correlations are always between minus 1 and 1, and they always look a bit like this. So this is a very strong correlation, it's almost a line, this is a perfect correlation, that is a line, but if it's 0, it's more of a circular scatter plot. If you have your variance covariance matrix, this is a small detail that will be a bit important in the course if you want to exactly replicate some numeric results. This is the way we compute the variance covariance matrix. So we take the sum of an element minus its mean times an element of another variable minus its mean, and then we can divide it either by n minus 1 or n. I'll divide it here by n minus 1. So if we do this for our data that we had here, so we take this minus its mean times that minus its mean plus this minus its mean times that minus its mean, etc. If we take that sum and then divide it by n minus 1, we'll get these elements. This is just a subpart of the bigger matrix. In R, we can use COF for this, to get a variance covariance estimate. Now, there's a little thing here with this n minus 1. This is an unbiased estimator, which means the expected value will equal sigma. It's not that important. It's just that it means that in general, we will expect this thing to be correct. In our course, we're going to do it a slightly different. So the nice thing about this unbiased estimator, which is very commonly used, is that it will have an expected value that equals the variance covariance matrix. In our course, we're going to divide by n rather than n minus 1, because it will lead to the maximum likelihood estimate. And I'll come back to maximum likelihood estimation in the lecture. This will be important to make the math work out. It's mainly important so that you can get yourself the same results as you will get into the software, and you understand why it's slightly different maybe. So here we divide by n, not n minus 1. And both are correct in a way. If n goes to infinity, it doesn't matter at all. Actually, if you have like 100 people, then it already doesn't really matter. But it is important for some exact results. So in R, the COF function returns an unbiased estimator, divided by n minus 1, but we can use that, so I'll call it S star here, to get our maximum likelihood estimator S, which is n minus 1 divided by n times S star. So in Lavan, actually the software we use, this correction is already applied, so that might help you understand why you get some different results. In general, if you see in my slides S, it means the maximum likelihood estimate, and S star will mean the unbiased estimator. Finally, we can standardize these covariance to correlation matrix by taking an element and dividing it by the product of the square roots of the elements, which simply means we take, for example, 0.35 here, and we divide it by the square root of 1.11 times the square root of 1.18. And then we get a nice value between minus 1 and 1 that we can interpret. In R, we can use cough to core for that. So to give a small example of what I just said, here I have a data set in R. And it has neuroticism scores, a lot of people, 5 variables. They are not really continuous because they're ordinal. So the assumption of normality here is already tricky. But let's just say they're ordinal, they're continuous. We can compute the means with call means in R. This will give us a mean factor. And we can see that it's the same as, I have to add this one, as 1 over n times the sums. It's the same thing. We can get the unbiased variance coverage estimate with cough. And this is the same as this expression here. Now, in this expression, I use matrix algebra, where this is a matrix operator. So if you don't follow this and you want to do it element-wise, like I do in the slides, that's of course perfectly fine. But it could be good practice to see why this would be the same as what I showed in the slides. Now the maximum likelihood estimate is n minus 1 divided by n times this estimate. And that's the same as this. You'll see that these values are exactly the same. This might also, again, be a good practice to see why this is the case if you really want to go into the more mathematical detail. Now that's all I want to say in this short video lecture, and I'll see you all in the course on Tuesday.